I'm Sarah, and thank you for inviting me. I'm a graphic designer. Thanks for the introduction. I was born in Belgium, and I studied graphic design there. But then I moved to Holland, where I did some more studying, and then moved to England, to London, where I moved for a job and ended up staying for 13 years. And recently moved back to Belgium about 4 years ago. And when I moved back to Belgium, that was because of family reasons. We ended up having two kids in London, and it became unsustainable financially to raise a family and continue being a graphic designer working for a cultural sector. So when I moved back, the school where I teach invited me to do a PhD. So that's what I'll be talking about today. And it's a bit of a weird title, but I thought maybe they're intriguing words. And they're all to do with my PhD. It's about a bar, a location, multi-art, a way of collaborating, and about what you name these things, Jean Pleur, how you call yourself. So those are the three elements to the talk. So the first one is recto verso bar, and that's about a place, about a location. And this morning when I spoke to my husband on the phone, panicking about putting this together, he said, you gotta put some pictures of your own work in there, not just of the stuff you're researching. So there's a bit of my stuff in there too. And so that's what I'd start with, which is this. It's an art center in Brussels called Wheels. And in 2008, I won the competition to design the identity. And this is the logo, which is based on the building. And for 10 years, I designed all their printed matter and also developed a typeface together with Jo de Baardemaker, which is based on Belgian road signs, because we wanted to make an identity that felt like it had always been there, that you didn't have to think about it, that it kind of felt like just it had a presence, but it wasn't over talking louder than the art. But it also was influenced by Marcel Brotaerts, who's a Belgian artist who used a lot of typography in his work, and someone who I've been interested in for a long time. And we ended up using his technique for making vacuum plastic in the signage of the building. And this is another example of a Belgian artist who uses typography in his work, who you all know, Magritte. And so from then on, I was interested in, I guess I've always been interested in history. When I studied graphic design, we were taught by artists and illustrators, and we got no graphic design history or no theory of typography, no nothing. So my whole kind of professional career has been trying to educate myself in a way, and I'm still trying to do that. In 2008, when we founded Occasional Papers with Anthony, that's my partner, Hudek, it all started with this, which was a tiny exhibition in an art gallery in London at Pump House Gallery of flyers by Ken Briggs, who's a modernist English graphic designer who designed flyers for the National Theatre. And my friend Fraser Muggeridge, who's also a graphic designer, said, hey, you gotta go see that show, it's amazing, nobody's going, it's in the middle of nowhere. And he said, oh, what can we do about it? And Anthony, my partner, who's an art historian, said, hey, maybe this is the way we can start our publishing company. Like, let's go and meet this guy, Ken Briggs, and make a book about him. So we had 2 weeks before the closing of the exhibition, and we went to meet Ken, we interviewed him, we transcribed the interview, edited it, designed it, and printed it in time for the closing of the show to be able to bring all our friends to go there and see this work and celebrate him. And it was not more than a tiny little booklet. Oh, sorry, I'll just go back. Can I go back? Yeah. Sometimes you just need a deadline to get something going, and sometimes you don't have to be like the right person to do stuff just to get something going in a way, because like this whole PhD as well has been really daunting because I'm not a design historian, I'm a graphic designer. But since the topic of the PhD is graphic design from Belgium and nothing has ever been done about it, I figured someone might as well get started. So I'm gonna play you a little snippet of Ken Briggs, who's talking when you're interviewing him.
Did say, why didn't you give a talk about what you do? And so I did. And I tried to flit it through very quickly, and there was an outcry. He said, for Christ's sake, let's look at the bloody thing before you switch off. So I had to go back again. And that was, I just found it too embarrassing, really.
He's talking about giving a lecture very much like this and being too shy to speak and going too fast, and the students asked him to do it again. And he was kind of forgotten when we met him. There was one piece in an article about theater brochures by Richard Hollis where he was mentioned. But I think it's quite telling, and it's the reason why we started Occasional Papers, is that the histories of the famous successful people are the ones that get repeated, and there are millions and millions of designers, of artists, who maybe were not good at promoting themselves, or who are too shy, or for other reasons, were being forgotten. And that's those histories from not only graphic design, but also fine art or filmmaking are what we're trying to share with Occasional Papers. And following that, I was invited to curate a conference at another amazing place called St. Bride Library in London. And we decided to do it about history. And this was in 2011. And try to talk about how we make graphic design history today from different angles. Should it be about biography? We got someone talking about multidisciplinarity, all kinds of different angles. But what was fun about it was that I was co-curating it with a French design historian, Catherine Desmet, and she was giving me all this reading material along the way. And we realized that there isn't one book that collects historiography, which is how you do writing about how to write history. So it's not case studies. It's not like this is the most amazing work. It's more like, should history be based on biography? Should it be based on people? Should it be based, what nationalities are we looking at? All the different ways of doing history. So we gathered all of that together in this book. So it was from the 1980s when Massimo Vignelli did the first address saying, guys, we need to do something about our history, until 2011, which was when we published the book. And it's also only writing in English because we didn't have a budget for translation, and we were limited to what we could read. But when I showed this book to my PhD supervisor, she fell off her bum. She said, Sarah, that's unbelievable. You can fit all that stuff in one book. It's crazy. Is that all that's been written about it? Then I moved back to Belgium, and I thought, what shall I do my research about? And I realized that there wasn't anything done about Belgian graphic design history. And this is another example of a project that I had done where, that shows how I was already thinking about it. And this is a building in Brussels. So Belgium is in the middle of Europe, and in the middle of Belgium is the capital, Brussels. And in 1958, they had a World Expo, and it was quite a big deal. And one of the buildings is this one, the Atomium. And Lucien de Roux is the guy who designed the identity for the World Expo. And when I was invited, these are some other typefaces he designed. And when I was invited to do the identity for Art Brussels, I decided to use his typeface and update it and add different letters to it for the identity. As often typefaces do, type designers do, you do a revival. Sorry. My timer is not on, so I'm a bit confused. I'll just look at the boards when I have to stop. Sorry. So this is where Belgium is. A lot of people, in Belgium we have a joke, like if you say to an American, I'm from Belgium, they say, is it in Brussels? So I thought I should put a slide showing That's Europe. Belgium is in the middle. It's a tiny country. It was founded in 1830. Nobody really was asking for Belgium. It's true. It was a part of Holland, and there was an uprising against the Dutch cruelty, and so the British people decided to make a country to have a buffer between France and Holland, because they didn't want France to then occupy it and have more power and get closer to the UK. And then they put an English nephew on the throne. So Belgium exists of two parts. It's a Dutch-speaking and a French-speaking part who don't get along. And in the middle is Brussels, who's owned by everybody. In the elections last month, the top part voted extreme right wing and the bottom part voted green and socialist. And now we have to try and make a government. We'll see how that works. So this is the one book about Belgian graphic design history that was in existence. And this is a book that I've always cherished. That's the one book that I was reading when I was studying, which is Graphic Design, A Concise History by Richard Hollis. And at the back of the book, he's got an overview of all the countries he's looked at. And as you see, there's Central Europe, France, all the neighboring countries, but no Belgium. And I put this in there because in the book, he has a beautiful Cooper Union logo by Herb Lubalin. But I put it there because in the book, Richard Hollis says that graphic design kind of only started in the middle of this century. So I decided to start my research vaguely there, after the Expo 58, and ended kind of roughly before the computers came, so late 70s. And so I have no training as a design historian, so I just started Googling and searching in archives and found this archive, the Letterenhuis, and realized that a lot of these archives are built around biographies, they're built around people. So, one of the things I did was go and meet these people. A lot of this generation are still alive. Nobody knows about them. Let's go talk to them and find out what they've done. And looking at other projects abroad, like this one by Dutch graphic design, or this one of New Zealand graphic design, you realize that that's exactly what maybe I shouldn't have been doing. And there's also this movie about graphic design in Canada that just came out that repeats the problem that if you base it on biography, on people, you kind of go for the more successful ones in a way. And in fact, the problem is, what I'm not saying is that you end up with the same white male guys. And how can you go around that when those works are the ones that even end up in the archives? And so I've talked about this issue before, and I was at the design conference in Antwerp recently, and one of those guys was in the audience, and afterwards he asked the question. He said, yeah, but there were no women at the time, you should stop going on about it. And this is the flyer of his company, which I found in the archives, and there is the woman who was working in his company. So this text has been really essential for me. It's a text by Martha Scotford where she's saying, it's from the reader that I was showing you earlier, it's a reprint, but she's saying we need to do messy history. Rather than retelling stories of he did this, we need to kind of look at other people, look at people who are assessing people, and yeah, make it messy. So this is my archive, which also is still based around people, because how else are you going to organize it? So I went back to the Expo thinking, okay, I don't want to go via Lucien de Roux, the guy, how else can I go? So I looked at, I started looking, maybe it's not about people, maybe it's about places. So this is an example of an exhibition that took place at the same time as the Expo, organized by a group of artists who were protesting about not being included in the exhibition. It's the G58, and they designed their own catalog. It's way before Lucy Lippard ever made her numbers catalogs. So it's a catalog made of by other artists. I'm going to have to speed up a bit. This is the Chamber of Belgian Graphic Designers, which is also another way, I thought, a way into the stuff. And they had a recto verso bar. So it was a self-organized group of designers who decided to have a house where they would get together and get organized and work around things like professional practice, competitions, education, public relations, and exhibiting. And they ended up having a bar in there called the Recto Verso Bar. And I found out who they were and what they were doing. And they also had agreements about pricing, so they wouldn't go competing against each other. And they were politically active. They had organized exhibitions of their work. And I just went through the whole list of the members, rather, and there were some women in there. Unfortunately, so I'll just show you some examples of some of the, these are the people in charge. No, the stuff I've been finding, Luc van Malde. Some of the events they were organizing around protesting for Chile or raising money. This one is a poster by Baudouin de Lara already then, complaining about the Declaration of Human Rights, that we should be thinking about nature. This is one, so Baudouin de Lara also designed the interior typeface and identity. This is some of his work in the 60s. And in 2010, I was invited to design the identity of that biennial. It's a biennial in Kortrijk in Belgium. And the only thing they told me is you have to use this logo, which was designed by Baudouin in 68. So I decided to develop the logo and add more letters to it, similar to the Art Brussels identity. And then add some depth and some gradients to it. I thought I'd show it on this conference because it's kind of similar. We also made some notebooks that we made by spray painting. But unfortunately, the Belgian Chamber of Graphic Designers ended because they were fighting, and then the Flemish and the Walloons started their own companies, and there were many other organizations, but at the moment there isn't any. And there's also nothing organized by the government because its culture is split into the two communities, which means there's not one archive of graphic design, which means that a lot of these people I've been talking to don't even know where to go with their stuff. So apart from location, how else you can try and undo this biographical focus is maybe by looking at collaboration, at how the different people were involved. And this is Janine Behagel, one of the few women I found. And I've been totally obsessed about her, trying to find her work. It's been like 3 years and I managed to track down her son last week. But she was one of the few practicing graphic designers I've been able to find the work of, and I found these two posters she made. And so she traveled a lot. She studied in Dusseldorf. She ended up studying at the Royal College. She had her own design studio, but then in the early 70s, she stopped and became an artist. So her work has to be somewhere, but I cannot find it anywhere. This is another example, Paul Ibu. He's like the Paul Rand of Belgium, if you could say it. He's like, someone once compared him to your president because he's quite a character. He's very full of himself, to put it mildly. But, he designed a lot of logos for banks and like he's the modernist designer. Oh God, I have to really get fast, sorry. He also designed a lot of work in three dimensions, like these things. But he considers himself a multi-artist, someone who's not only a designer, but also an artist. And he also made self-initiated work, such as this blank die-cut book. But who is not alive anymore, he's his partner, Lilian Emma Stahl, who, over the few years I've been working with him, I started to realize was behind a lot of his projects. She said, as this one, Multi-Art, which was a press and a bookshop that they had in Antwerp in the 70s, early 70s. And their idea was that they would make affordable art. They would collaborate with artists, commission them to make a paper sculpture, and print it in a few hundred copies, and people could buy it for affordable prices, have it at home, and have multiple ones that were traveling. So this is the shop. And there you see Lilian, and she's the center of the room. And it took me, I've written a few articles about it, and it's interesting to see how every article I'm shifting from multi-art by him to by them to by her. And these are some of the objects they made together with artists. And these are the posters. And I went back to the archive last week to try and find some more images and discovered even some instances where Paul Hibou had taken out the name of the other designer she collaborated with and put his own name on it. So he's an active people. Yeah, and he's being celebrated as a Belgian graphic designer, but really he didn't do it all alone. And I also don't want to say that she did everything, because he was totally part of it, and it's hard for me to guess exactly where the boundaries lie. But I'll just skip this. This is a book I did in three dimensions, so I put it in there to show you some of my work. This is another example of a collaboration between an artist and a designer. That's going back to Marcel Brotaerts, who I showed you in the beginning. It's an invitation card where Marcel is announcing to the world he's going to stop being a poet and become an artist. He then became a really successful artist. And it's overprinted onto magazines. And he's saying, me too, I'm going to earn some money in the world. And this invite is worth thousands of dollars. It's in the collection of MoMA. And yet, when you look at the MoMA website, it's co-designed by Marcel and Hanose. And in books, Hanose's name is hardly ever there. But you can see his name it's actually printed on the invite. It's not printed, designed by Marcel Brotaerts. It's written on the invite. So he's another guy I've become interested in. And these are some examples of his work. And the last part of the talk is Jean Pleur, which is a different word for Jean-Jacques Stiefenhofer. And it means, Jean Pleur means, it's a reference to Jean-Jacques, which is his name, but it also means Jean Pleur. It makes me want to cry. And he put it on his designs when he wasn't happy with it. You know, you only put you put your name on something when you're proud of it. But there's a lot of design that's being done that's uncredited or that's, you know, credited wrongly or whatever. And how can we include that into our research? And this example is another funny one. It's a lot of these posters in Belgium have got a label on it which says Vrij van Zegel. It means there's no stamp on it. And there's I was told a collector in Japan who once emailed one of the archivists saying, who is this designer? No stamp on it. I really like him. So I've been also trying to go to other archives like these from the Socialist Party or about national elections to try and find work that's not under someone's name, that's anonymous. That's beautiful design, but how can we include it somehow in this history? I'll just skip that. And the other way we could think about it is maybe to go to teaching to places like this. So I've also been requesting all the names of the people who graduated and are looking at all the female students and trying to find them this way. To end maybe about how to do this messy history is maybe also to do it as personally as possible and to be as honest as possible about the fact that I'm a graphic designer, I'm not an art historian. These are some examples of books that talk about the same work, and this is Richard Hollis talking about it, who's a designer. Or Meg's talking about it, or Vlasikov, and it's interesting to read the way they describe the work, the way the impact it had, or the way it was made. And something I'm interested in thinking about is how what's the difference between someone who knows how to make the stuff, how is it made, how they can do this research as well. And to conclude, I'm preparing an exhibition in the Design Museum in Ghent at the moment, and I'm trying to get some of this stuff into an exhibition also as a way of ending it, because it's become an addiction to try and find more people and more work. But I'm trying to find a way to organize it in this way that I've been talking about. And so I've come up with this idea that maybe it's going to be organized per topic or per terms, and terms that are relevant to me and my practice, such as color, collaboration, seriality, social relevance, format, three-dimensionality. There'll be an education area, and maybe to try and go away from what I've been talking about and more different way of looking at our history. I'm also working with my students to make Wikipedia pages, and we're publishing a book by a young Swedish collective that talks about the messy history of women in typography. Thank you very much.